In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the many blessings which you poured forth upon us this day. We ask you, Lord, to help us to see more clearly what those blessings were and help us to appreciate them more fully. And as we come here at the end of this day, help us, Lord, to become refreshed so that we may understand and see where you are leading and guiding us as your church, as your bride, as your body. And help us to give us a spirit of wisdom, help us be open to that spirit of wisdom, and help us to grow more closely to you and to each other. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, welcome everyone. We're going to go ahead and begin with the opening up of the Word, and then we will go into our presentation, which is the second half, which last week we talked about the Holy Spirit, and this week we'll be talking about how the Holy Spirit infuses and creates the church. So, this is from the readings from this past weekend. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Jesus addressed this parable to those who were convinced of their own righteousness and despised everyone else. Two people went up to the temple area to pray. One was a Pharisee, and the other was a tax collector. The Pharisee took up his position and spoke this prayer to himself. O God, I thank you that I am not like the rest of humanity, greedy, dishonest, adulterous, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, and I pay tithes on my whole income. But the tax collector stood off at a distance and would not even raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast and prayed, O God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, the latter went home justified, not the former. For whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and the one who humbles himself will be exalted. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. All right, well, you'll find that Jesus likes this very last line, whoever humbles himself, the one who exalts himself will be humbled, and the one who humbles himself will be exalted. This is actually what's referred to in Scripture as a eschatological reversal, which is a nice, big, funny way of saying that Jesus is going to come to reverse everything. And he actually reverses the way in which we see and the way in which we approach things. One of the other ones, which is a very common and famous one, is the last shall be first and the first shall be last. It's another one which is actually these types of sayings where Jesus starts to flip words and flip meanings. And actually he starts to flip people's assumptions on their heads. Jesus will do this very frequently throughout the Gospels. And the one which he does today is the understanding of humility as well as the understanding of righteousness, because it was understood that those persons who fulfilled God's law in the ancient times, the Jews, understood that people who fulfilled God's law were the righteous ones. And so that's why actually all the different laws, not just the Ten Commandments, but the 560 laws that were contained within the law of Moses, the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, is that in order to be righteous, you had to fulfill all of these laws. Which is actually why St. Paul in the New Testament will say that he was what? The Pharisee of Pharisees. He followed all of the law. Which doesn't mean that he just knew the Ten Commandments. He knew every single bit of the first five books of the Bible. And he followed every single one to the T. And what he says later on is he says, it's not possible to follow this. It's impossible. But see, many of the people, especially the Pharisees, they made it a point of pride. They were very proud in the fact that they actually followed, or at least attempted to follow, the smallest letter of the law. Which is what Jesus reverses in the gospel today as he says, it's not by your own effort, it's not by your willpower, it's not by following the law you will find justification, that you will find yourself righteous. Which really turns the Pharisees, and would have not been a very comfortable topic for the Pharisees, because that's exactly how they understood that they became righteous. What Jesus actually refers to them as what will make you righteous is when you recognize that you're sinners, when you recognize that you have failed, when you recognize that you can't fulfill the law, when you come and beg on your knees, God, when you crawl humbly before him, and you what? Like the tax collector who today, all he says is what? He says, the tax collector stood at a distance, would not even raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, O God, be merciful to me, a sinner. It's actually very similar to actually what David does in the Old Testament. David, who doesn't try to excuse his behavior, doesn't try to blame other people for what he's done. When David is accused, King David in the book of Samuel, when he's accused and when his sin is made known, David is the one person who's honest and says, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. So in this, we'll find that Jesus' understanding of justification, his understanding of righteousness, is not something which is separate from the Old Testament, but that he is coming to correct those ways in which the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the leaders of Israel had slowly gone astray. And that this understanding of humility, which sometimes we avoid humility in our lives because I think that we have a fear of humility, just as Adam and Eve, and actually all of humanity has a fear of humility, because when we have ever encountered humility, especially in the world, what I think that we confuse humility with is humiliation. Now, none of us likes to be humiliated. And actually, for human beings, when human beings humble each other, they actually don't end up humbling each other. They end up humiliating each other. Human beings will step upon one another and crush them underfoot. Though as soon as someone falls down, everyone will gang up and then again, make fun and things like this. We see it in middle school, high school, even in the workplace today, where someone makes a mistake and everyone, what, crushes that person down. But see, what Jesus has come is not to crush us underfoot. It actually says very clearly Jesus has come to what? To raise us up. You'll find actually this reversal of raising up and exaltation, also one of these reversals that Jesus will do in the New Testament. That Jesus has come to raise us up. The way in which he's come to raise us up is through humility, not humiliation. Because what Jesus comes to do is he comes to show us our real authentic place in God's plan. And that our real authentic place in God's plan is not to be God, which is what Adam and Eve tried for, but it's also not to be garbage and dirt. It's to reckon ourselves as small, but precious in the eyes of God. That every single individual is loved by God. And we see this actually, especially from the Good Samaritan story, the one who takes care of the most lowly. Jesus goes out to the most lowly, especially in Luke's gospel. You'll find out that he seeks out the lowly, the sick, the poor. He seeks out the tax collectors, the people who were the cast off, the people who were hated. Because oftentimes within that grouping of people, they might be sinners, but at least they know that they're aware of it. And Jesus can speak to a person who's at least honest and aware of their sin. He has a very difficult time breaking through the hardened hearts of people who don't think that they have any sin, who don't think that they are unjustified, who don't think that they are without justice. The ones like the Pharisees who think that what? It's interesting because also within this particular passage, you'll find that the Pharisee, although he thinks he's praying to God, who it actually very says right here, the Pharisee took up his position and spoke this prayer to himself. He's praying to himself. He says he's praying to God, but in all reality, he's praying to himself. Thank you, God, that I'm not like this person over here. Thank you, God, that I'm not that person there. Thank you, God, that I'm not like Glenn. Thank you, God, that I'm not like Laura. Thank you, God, that I'm not like Mark. Thank you, God, that I'm not like all of you. Thank you, God, that I'm not as bad as all of you. See, at the end of the day, when we start comparing ourselves, and sometimes that's what we can do, especially make ourselves feel better, we can start comparing ourselves to other. At least I'm not like Donald Trump. At least I'm not like Hillary Clinton. At least I'm not like this person. At least I'm not like Hitler. At least I haven't done this person's sins over here. And as soon as we start falling into that trap, we become arrogant and prideful because we don't know into the heart of another person. And actually, even the gravest sinner might have the softest heart towards God. And then when we especially slip into comparison, we start comparing ourselves to others, we don't find ourselves righteous. We find ourselves without the presence of Christ. We find ourselves actually praying to ourselves. Which is why all that Jesus asks from us, he doesn't ask for perfection. He doesn't ask that we are without sin. What he asks us to be is honest. Honest with our sin and not trying to pass the buck, not trying to focus on other people, but saying, Lord, where are you calling me individually to encounter you in the mercy which you have for me? Because it's also that a person who is justified, a person without sin, has no need for mercy. Only a person who has sinned and is in need of help is one who can actually receive the mercy of Jesus. So just take just one simple question for just a few minutes to talk around in our groups tonight. Is where has the Lord been offering us maybe opportunities today to authentic humility? Where has the Lord been calling out? And maybe has there been any moments throughout the day where you might have had a humbling experience? Or you might have actually had a moment where the Lord raised you up where he showed you your authentic identity, again, those positive experiences, but also the moments where maybe we have slipped into that false arrogance, and or at least temptation or something like that. Does that make sense? All right. Take maybe about five. All right. I hope everyone had a good discussion tonight. All right. For tonight's class, for tonight's series, we're going to be going into the continuation of what we talked about last week in terms of the Holy Spirit. But before I did that, I just wanted to bring up one issue because I know that a couple of persons had asked the question and would like to have had it addressed. So, and it's on divorce and remarriage and things like that. We are going to have a whole class which is devoted to this when we come to the sacrament of marriage. But I just did want to touch upon it real briefly because many people do come to the Catholic Church and they've had prior marriages and they've been divorced and remarried and things of this nature. And so the Catholic Church does have a particular position on that because we don't recognize divorce. We recognize that marriage is for life. But we also recognize the reality that oftentimes in the brokenness of humanity that many people go through the motions and get married and things like this and it ends in tragedy. And a lot of these things, oftentimes, we can work with. And so that's what we have, a process, which is a little bit different, which is called the annulment process. And so some persons, I know, had asked about it because they had expressed reservations about prior marriages and things like that. So we're going to work with everyone individually. But I can say this, the process for RCIA, we're going to talk to those who need to individually, but the process for RCIA is actually sped up by a year. Because the church, we want to bring people into the church, and we don't want to make them wait. So actually, if we get the paperwork done fairly shortly, then we will actually be able to guarantee a verdict and guarantee what needs to be done by April, so that you can come into the church. It does require, the only reason I normally like to bring it up when we come naturally to it within the sacrament of marriage, and when we naturally come to it in the sixth and ninth commandment, but just because there is a time crunch, on when we need to process the paperwork, because it does take at least several months to process through and to get all those things worked out, which do. But we can work with that. And again, Jesus himself was a person who called people who had had many marriages. The woman at the Samaritan at the well, she had been married 5 times, and yet Jesus still called her. And so we as well, we also do the same. We will work with people and we will walk through the cases and we'll get all that situated. So if you get a phone call from either myself or from Deacon Jerry actually handles a lot of the annulment issues. We'll walk through that with you and I can explain more in detail. That is not going to be, that shouldn't be a problem. So does anyone have any questions in particular on that before I go on? Because we will come to this again. We'll cover the theology of it as well as what it is, because we look at Jesus' words itself, it says, when we look at unlawful marriages. So, but for tonight, because we also do understand that this understanding of marriage is important, because Jesus came to marry the human race to God. This notion of actually Jesus as the bridegroom. As Jesus the bridegroom who comes to save us, the bride, his church, the body of Christ, that's what we call ourselves. If you look at the notion of, in the Old Testament, of how the people of Israel, the chosen people who God made a covenant with, that language of covenant is very different than the ancient understanding of how the people would relate to the gods. The Mesopotamian gods, if you were in Syria, or if you were in Iraq, or modern-day Mesopotamia, which would be Syria, Iraq, Iran, all that, which was the Mesopotamian gods, a pantheon of gods, and they related to their gods by cause and effect. We did a rain dance, we got rain. We did what we were supposed to do. We got what we wanted. We were obedient, so forth and so on. It was a cause and effect. It was a contract relationship. Same thing was actually true with the ancient Greeks, is that you took on the patronage of a god. Each city had their own god that they worshipped. And if that god did not give them what they wanted, they would switch to a different god. And you can read about this actually in the Iliad, the Odyssey, and all these different things, these different cities who have different gods. As well as obviously Greek mythology, usually have wars break out when cities change gods. So the notion of actually in the ancient world, the ancient pagan world of how people related to gods was always by cause and effect, contract. Therefore, if the contract was broken, is that the two sides were no longer bound. But see, the language which is used in the Old Covenant and which really marks Judaism, the Jewish religion, as very different than all the other world religions at the time is this notion of covenant. Covenant, which actually had a connotation to marriage. It's the same type of language as even our today, our modern understanding of a marriage, which is what? Faithfulness, fidelity, and fruitfulness. That this is what God actually asked of his people. He asked them to be faithful to him, perpetually faithful. He asked them not to follow other gods, not to have what actually in the book of Hosea would be called other spouses. He asked them not to cheat on him. They wanted them to be faithful. He wanted them to be a faithful bride. And that he actually wanted this to be perpetual. He didn't want them to ever not just go for about 100, 200 years. He wanted them not only just worship him exclusively, but he wanted them also to do this faithfully. So therefore, the notions of faithfulness and fidelity, which are found as primary to the relationship between the Jews and God. Now, the Jews oftentimes were not this. And when they were not this, they oftentimes ended up in exile. But they also were called to what? He promises to Abraham that he will increase his descendants like all, and they will outnumber the stars, outnumber the sand on the shores of the sea. So when you look at this, this faithfulness, this fruitfulness and fidelity, which are actually hallmarks of the Jewish faith, what faithful Jews are called to be faithful to, is that this notion was also understood to be a covenant. And we could get into, I have a whole presentation, which I do at other times during the year, on what actually the word covenant actually means in this notion, which is a very heavy and is very pregnant throughout the entirety of the Old Testament. As God refers to himself as the bridegroom, as the husband, and that Israel is more often than not referred to as an unfaithful bride. So what Jesus actually, the understanding of Jesus in the New Testament, Jesus comes to save his bride. Jesus who is God, Jesus who is God made flesh, comes to save the bride, which is the wholeness of humanity, not just all the women. He wants all the women and all the men. Because in the wholeness of humanity, in both male and female, and with all of humanity joined together, you have the bride of God, which in the Old Testament will be a singular, exclusive people. There's an exclusive relationship with the people of Israel and God. But in the New Testament, it becomes inclusive, open to anyone who wants it. That's what actually Jesus offers. He offers universal acceptance into being, what, part of his bride. And that's actually what Jesus offers. He offers to his bride a particular gift. He offers the gift of eternal life and freedom. Two things which are offered to the bride. It's interesting, he doesn't offer these things to individual people. He offers them to what? Any individual person who adheres to the bride. That's what St. Paul talks about in the New Testament, this understanding of membership, being a member of the bride. That in the bride, or being a member of the church, is that there are, in the church, there are what? There are many members, all with different functions. Almost actually the language which he uses is very similar to the organs of a body, or the features of a body. It's also why it's referred to as the body of Christ. The church is the body of Christ, all of which are not the same, and you don't want everything to be exactly the same, because that would be ugly, and it wouldn't work very well. It's actually also one of the reasons why we believe that, for instance, prayers for each other is also very helpful and pleasing to God. God doesn't need us to make intercessions on behalf of others to know what other people need. So God doesn't need me to know and to make a prayer on behalf of Jerry, because God knows what Jerry needs, Deacon Jerry, or Father Raj, or anyone in this room. And likewise, God doesn't need you to pray for me to inform him of what I need. You might think you know what I mean. You might know what it is. More humility or whatever it may be. But still, God doesn't need this information. But he actually asked the people, and he asked all of us, and this is common throughout the scripture, to pray for one another. Because one of the notions of intercessory prayer, when we intercede on behalf of others, this shows a unity which God desires for us. It shows and demonstrates a unity which was actually lost as a consequence of sin. A unity which is found in love. That when one member of the body, as St. Paul says, is suffering, all the members suffer with it. And when one member glories, all the members glory with it. When one member is sick, the other what? Members flood nutrients, flood things to that member of the body so that it regains health. And because this shows God's unity. It's a demonstration of the unity of God's plan, and actually the unity which is foundational and which is one of the things that actually humanity desires in and of itself, is this unity. But see, this unity is lost because of sin, but this unity is restored because Jesus gives us the Spirit. Jesus gives the Spirit to his bride. He gives the Spirit to the church, which enables his church, which enables his bride, which enables his body. All three of those words are synonymous: bride, body, church. all of that enables them to have that which was lost, which is eternal life and freedom. Now, individually, all of us have what? Life. And individually, all of us have free will. But see, just because we have free will does not necessarily mean that we have freedom. Because you can have free will and it leads you to slavery. The only way which your free will leads you to freedom is if we are in unity with one another, if we are truly members of the body. Does this make sense? So in Christ, now when Christ gives the Holy Spirit, it's interesting, when he gives the Holy Spirit, it's different depending on which gospel you read. If you read the Gospel of Luke, the giving of the Holy Spirit is found actually in the Pentecost event. It's in actually Luke's gospel was probably originally one document, and it was just Luke. But it was Luke's gospel and Acts of the Apostles that we've separated into two books. But originally it was one document. And so actually that's why if you read the Gospel of Luke and you go and read from Luke, instead of going right into John, you read Luke and go right into Acts, it's one systematic flow. Because there was originally one piece. So in Luke's gospel, in the beginning of Acts, you'll find that the Holy Spirit, and this is ultimately the part which is, separates the gospel, when the Holy Spirit is given. The Holy Spirit is given at Pentecost. In John's gospel, the Holy Spirit is given and is actually given to the apostles in a different moment. Does anyone know when it is? Not you. I know you know. Anyone? The Holy Spirit, if you open up your scriptures and you go to the 20th and 21st chapter, you'll find a moment, it's in the 21st chapter, where Jesus will breathe upon the apostles. It's a very interesting point. He breathes upon them. And when he breathes upon them, in John's understanding, which is that that's then the end of John's gospel, the breathing upon the apostles, when he breathes upon them, it's also... He does the same thing that God the Father does over the waters at the very beginning of creation. When he breathes upon the waters and life springs about. God the Father breathes on the water. God breathes in the waters. Jesus breathes on the apostles. And then they what? Are flooded with new life. They become infused with the Holy Spirit. Actually, the understanding of breath in the Old Testament is always associated with the Spirit. The breath of God, breathing, when God breathes into Adam, he breathes the Spirit. When Jesus breathes into the apostles, he breathes in the new Spirit, which brings about unity. And it starts healing all of the divisions which are found in the Old Testament, starting with Babel. Babel, which was the separation. Is everyone familiar? Is anyone here not familiar with the Tower of Babel? So everyone is familiar with the Tower of Babel, yes? No? A couple? So if you look at the Old Testament, you'll find that all of a sudden, all people are united. Even after the fall, there still is a unity present after the fall of Adam and Eve. But you start to find the slow disintegration of human society and the human family. Until finally, there's this one culmination event where at the Tower of Babel is that all of humanity is united together in pride. And so they decide to build a tower which will rise up into the heavens itself and that where they can challenge God. So they decide to build this tower. And so actually, as a mercy to them, some people think it's a curse, but it's actually as a mercy to the people, because if they build this tower, they will destroy themselves if they try to compete with God. They try, again, now whether or not the story is historical again, or whether there's a lot of metaphor in it, I'm not sure. But still, I do know what the purpose of the story is that the story is that in this Tower of Babel, which is raised up, and they attempt to rise into the heavens, is that God, to save them, fractures their language. That all humanity originally speaks one language, and actually after the Tower of Babel, everyone will no longer be able to speak one to another. There's a fracturing of language. Language is no longer united. And actually in this, you'll find what the beginning of all different types of tongues. And so you'll have that people can no longer communicate because they can't communicate, they can't build anything, and they can't do what they were trying to do, which is to rise up into the heavens in pride. So what will happen as a result of the breathing of the Spirit is that, very interesting, in Luke's gospel, the apostles, who first of all are cowardly, they are sinful, they can't do what Jesus is called to, all of a sudden the Spirit comes down and lights upon them like fire upon their heads. They come out and they immediately start speaking in one tongue. And this one tongue, which is actually called tongues, in this one tongue, every single person that's in Jerusalem from all these different countries. There's about 20 different countries that everyone is gathered around, and everyone hears the apostles speaking in their original tongue. Because as soon as the Holy Spirit is given to the apostles, you find the Greek establishment of unity. Because one of the greatest ways in which we are disunited is in speech. Because the one tongue which unites all people together now will be the person of Jesus Christ, which is love, not pride and not hatred. Does this make sense?
This is at Pentecost?
This is at the Pentecost event. So at John, when John breathes, when the Gospel of John, when Jesus breathes upon the apostles, this is the giving over of the Holy Spirit, which will bring about, once again, like we said last time, the marks of the Holy Spirit being what? The unity which unifies the Father and Son together, that which brings the person who is so pronounced that it's a person who brings the Father closer to the Son and the Son closer to the Father, that this principle of unity is once again established within the human family, which brings about unity. Wholeness, which brings about a holiness as well as a holiness, which enables us to see ourselves as we truly are in humility, but also in glory. The universal quality to all people, as well as that there is the authority of the Spirit, which is also infused into the church so that the church can do what it is being called to do. Otherwise, we end up being a committee. So, you'll find that in, actually, the Eucharist, we call the Eucharist to be the pinnacle and summit of our faith, which is that we believe that the Eucharist is that which unifies all people together who are believers. That the Eucharist is the one thing which actually, that's also why we call it communion, communal union, that this is what the Eucharist does for us. Not just one moment in baptism where we're united, but actually consistently, each and every week, we are unified as the one body of Christ, in Christ by receiving and eating his very own body. That there is a unity which is present within this. And we'll see that actually in the baptism of Jesus, where the Holy Spirit comes down. Rose, can you turn down my mic just a little bit? Turn it down just a little. Yeah, it's starting to buzz. I don't know if anyone heard. I have very good hearing. Yep, that's good. Thank you. So you'll find that in the baptism of Jesus, where Jesus is baptized by John and claimed by the Father, baptism, which actually when you find the side of Christ pierced on the cross, this is in John's gospel, you'll find that Jesus' side is pierced by a lance. And very specifically, it'll say that what? Blood and water flow. Seeing that flowing of blood and water, John's gospel, which is also called the gospel of signs, John's gospel, blood and water symbolize our signs for two realities. Water, which comes from the side, which is how we are born again, and blood, which is how we are nourished and feed, and constantly in communion. Eucharist, baptism, flow from the side of Christ, and actually is the birth as well as the nourishment of the church, because from the side of Jesus, who is the new Adam, and if you know anything about the Adam and Eve story, from the side of Adam, Eve was created. And from the side of the new Adam, you will find that Jesus will create his new Eve, which is the church, his bride. Does this make sense? So, the Pentecost event, which is actually more than just tongues of fire coming down, this is a reunification of the human family. This is what Jesus has come to do. This is also what we refer to as that the second effect. Jesus came to redeem, to restore, and to sanctify. To redeem, to restore, and to elevate humanity. To redeem us, which is what he does on the cross. He redeems us by his blood. He pays the price. He buys out Satan. He pays the price for our salvation. And then he has to then do something before he brings us to his side, before he raises us up into the heavens, before he truly unites us as his bride, he has to restore us. Does anyone know what the words, everyone's familiar with the word, with restoration, like if you restore your car. So if you restore, or likewise also paintings, you restore paintings. Paintings have to be brought back to their original quality in order to be showcased. Likewise a car, you restore it. Jesus will do the same thing with humanity. He will restore it. And actually that process of restoration is ongoing right now. He is restoring creation. And it still is going on. Is that what happens though, it starts in this event, in the Pentecost event, where the church is created from the side of Christ and then infused with life. It's not just created, but it has to be infused with the Spirit. Adam is created, but then he's infused with the Spirit by God when he breathes the Spirit into him. So Jesus, again, the breathing into the Spirit, where you will have a reunification of the entire human family. Male and female are all called. Male is not above female. Female is not above male. All are called equally in perfect union and to be in perfect union. And so within this, you'll also find that they are filled with a passion, with a fire, and that they actually will find their place. They will know their place within God's cosmic plan. And we're still discovering this to this day. It's the fulfillment as the Spirit has led us and guided us and has slowly shown us more and more what God has planned for humanity. And this has been going on in the process of theology for a long time. So in this, where you'll find actually the 12 apostles who are mentioned, it also mentions that Mary is there. And we're going to get into Mary next week for why Mary is so important, because Mary has a central figure in the Gospels and she has a central placement at the Pentecost event. And there's a reason for that. Because actually what you'll find, and we'll get into this next week, but just as a precursor, Mary will show us actually what it means to be a disciple, what it means to be the bride, what it means to be the church, versus the apostles will give us encouragement because they'll show us that it's okay to screw up. But Mary will show us how to get it right. Some of you I know have been coming to my class on Mary, which I've been teaching on Sundays. So the recreation and restoration of the human family, which is that once again, humanity will become one, universal, pure, and a family with dominion, which is actually the notion of dominion is that which Adam and Eve had in the garden and lost in the garden. Dominion, authority will once be given to it. So with this, you will find that God first has to restore what his original plan was, because his original plan was good, and not everything can be undone. There are long-standing effects to what happens, and the reason for why not everything can become undone is because if God just immediately after the fall of Adam and Eve just totally reverses everything and just wipes away what they've done, the question becomes, why didn't God just fix it right after Adam and Eve screwed it up? Actually, that's something I asked when I was a teenager. God's so loving, why didn't he just fix it the whole, why do you have to go through this whole long, however thousand long years process it's been, why couldn't he just fix the whole thing immediately? Why? Why not? Why not just fix it right there? Because if he fixes it right there, what he negates is the effectiveness as well as the power of human actions. If he just undoes their choices, if he just undoes all of it, then what he also takes away is the meaning contained within human actions. Our actions have meaning. Our actions have power. Our actions actually can create. Our actions have long-standing meaning and power. Because they're effective, they have meaning. If our actions could just be washed away and wiped away without any consequence, just like, the Etch-a-Sketch? Okay, then there's no lasting value in that. God wants us to have lasting value. He wants us to have lasting meaning. And this is connected to our ability to act. To act not as slaves and to act not just as animals, but to act as free people. To act as free beings who choose to act in accordance with God's will. Something which chooses to act in accordance with God's will is always superior to something which is just following its nature without choice. Something which has freedom is always superior to that which does not have freedom. Does this make sense? So in correlation with that, there's when God will restore through this very long process, and still is this going on today, it's to what? It's actually to protect our meaning. To protect our search for meaning, our desire for meaning, as well as our ability to enter into and actually have meaning. To be able to, what we call, participate with God. God is the source of all meaning, the source of all love, and the source of all things. But God wants us to participate within that. Not just as slaves, but as Jesus says, I've not come to call slaves who don't have a choice. I've come to call friends. Friends who always have a choice. And so within this, actually, our ability to love. So some of the effects have temporal and eternal effect. Even after Jesus saves the bride, comes back and saves humanity, there still is long-lasting effects of sin. We still have this fundamental fight, which we now have to engage in. We still actually even have an addiction to sin even after Jesus saves us. We still, consistently fall. And as we talked about tonight in terms of humility, we still, even after baptism and after this, we still screw up. Which is why, thankfully, God never asked for perfection from his bride. What he asked for is honesty and what? Consistency. If we are consistently honest with our sin, consistently honest with God, consistently, he will always offer us mercy and forgiveness. Not just one time, not just seven times, but 70 times seven. And so, in correlation, the search, all of the things that cannot be undone, and one of the things that actually is not restored when Jesus comes and restores his church, one thing which is forever lost and which we'll never know, is original innocence. Innocence is lost. Innocence is never actually regained. Innocence once lost is always lost. The innocence of Adam and Eve, the innocence of the human race, the innocence. There's actually a beauty and there's also a joy in not knowing certain things. There is. Think about when you were a child. There was a joy in not knowing certain things. There's a joy, actually, when I was a little kid and I watched the TV and I really had no clue what was going on as my mom and dad were yelling at the TV because of various things that politicians were doing. And I just didn't understand. I now understand. That was bliss. That was bliss, not knowing. Now as I watch the TV and I'm screaming at the TV, now what? Innocence is lost. And there's a bliss. There's something good about innocence. But once innocence is lost, it's never regained. Innocence is lost. We now know sin. We also now know what? Good and evil. God doesn't take away the knowledge of good and evil. But the problem is that when good and evil originally affected humanity, not only did we lose innocence, but we also lost our connectedness to God, connectedness to each other, and connectedness to the world. What Jesus comes to restore is not the original innocence. What he comes to restore is that connectedness, that now we can be connected despite the fact that we know sin. And so what Jesus comes into the world to do is to once about bring about this oneness, this unity, and this wholeness. And so Jesus' sacrifice upon the cross is the conduit as well as the model by which he unleashes the Spirit upon the world. This is how he redeems us. It will also become the way in which he calls us to participate within it, because Jesus says very clearly several times in the Gospels, if you do not pick up your cross daily and follow me, you will have no place in my kingdom. The person who does not pick up their cross, again, will not have eternal life. We must. This is not only just, some people are like, well, Jesus saved us on the cross and that's the end. He redeemed us, now everything's great. Nope. This is now a pattern. It is a model. It is something that all people are called to embrace. Yes. By living in agape love, and by living in agape love, it's by living for the other more than yourself. Which if you live for the other more than yourself, you will feel like you are being crucified. And I'll give you a concrete example. Your children. If to really love your children the way that they need to be loved, they will become crosses. Beautiful crosses. My cross is easy, my burden is light. But they still will, your children will at times make you feel like you're being crucified. To actually raise them the way that they need to be raised. Now you don't have to raise them the way that they need to be raised. You can just take the short and easy way out. You can give them exactly whatever they want, or you can give them nothing at all. But see, actually, to find that narrow path of being a good parent, that's it. That's the cross. And it's really hard. And I have a lot of admiration for parents who strive for that. Another way in which actually is called to live the cross and to carry the cross daily is to be a good spouse. To love your spouse more than you love yourself. That, as I'm sure many of you can testify, that can feel like you're being crucified. To truly love another person, to forgive your spouse 70 times 7 can feel like you're being crucified. To actually take an interest in the things of the world without despairing and yet still being called to be in the world yet not of the world, that can feel like you're being crucified. Again, it's very simple things, but actually the simplest things are sometimes the hardest to do. So yeah, I told one of our parishioners at one time, he's like, what you're telling me is hard. And I was like, no, it's simple. It's just really hard to do. It's very simple. He's like, this is too much. I was like, no, it's simple. It's very simple. He's like, it's not simple. I said, it is simple. He's like, no, this is really hard. I said, yes, it is very hard, but it's also very simple. If that makes sense. So that's practical ways in which we carry across. And usually that's why I said that we're not usually going to have one monumental moment in our life where we're crucified. God will ask us to carry small splinters every day. And so in this, you'll find that as the side of Christ is pierced on the cross, where you'll find, again, by what tradition calls the Roman centurion Longinus will throw the spear into the side, blood and water will be released, and you'll find the new church. You'll find the church being created from the side of the new Adam, just as the old Eve was created from the side of the old Adam. So within this, as the Spirit is released upon the world, one of the notions that we always associate with the Holy Spirit is fire. And not fire, just be in the sense of, again, a little tongue of fire and things like that, and just the Holy Spirit is fire. No, fire means something. And it's the meaning, it's the symbolism of what fire means is actually what it's trying to give us a little hint of what the Holy Spirit actually is, or who the Holy Spirit is. Because it's more than just an element that we have little control over. Although it is true that with fire, we might be able to control it at certain times. We really have no control over fire, at least absolute control, just to talk to people in California. So when you look at fire, fire is one, it's difficult to control, but it also denotes an encounter. Every time that you find fire, for the most part in the Old Testament, you'll find that there's this encounter, an encounter with a personal encounter that's denoted by fire. You'll find it in the burning bush. The burning bush that when Moses encounters the burning bush, the bush which is a flame, it is also, every time, almost always you'll find this encounter, you'll find that it is consumed and yet it is left unharmed. The burning bush is consumed by fire and yet it's not burnt. You'll also find that in the book of Daniel, you'll find Elijah calls down fire, and at times fire will consume certain parts of the sacrifice and not consume others. Consume the tainted parts, consume sometimes even the altar, but leave the sacrifice untainted at various times. So you'll find this understanding of consumption of fire, fire which consumes, but anything which is good is always preserved. You'll find that Jeremiah will talk about how his heart was set on fire for the Lord. You'll also find that three young men are thrown into a fiery furnace in the book of Daniel. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are thrown into the fiery furnace, and yet their jailers are burnt to crisp by the flames coming from this furnace, and yet Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are what? They walk amongst the flames totally unharmed, consumed by the fire, but yet unharmed. Even to the point where King Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, will look down into the fire, into the flames, and he'll say, I thought we threw in three, but what I see is four, and the fourth looks like a son of God walking among. And so in this notion of fire, we find this notion, one, of encounter, but you also find that fire is always in constant movement, going back to the Holy Spirit, which moves us into action. And likewise, the Spirit will always destroy sloth. Sloth, which wants us to stay static, passive, inactive, languid, lazy. Again, that the Holy Spirit will always move us into action, move us into showing our love for our neighbor, move us to showing love for God. The Holy Spirit will always move us. As fire is constantly moving, it's never stopping. There's actually a frenetic energy to it, and that's actually, there's a frenetic energy to the Spirit, which you'll also find that this third notion is that you'll find passion. We use fire to talk about passion all the time, because the Holy Spirit wants us to fall passionately in love with God. And actually, the Holy Spirit wants us to fall passionately in love with one another. It doesn't want us to be without passion. It doesn't want us to be Puritans who think that we have to get rid of the feelings, get rid of things like that. No, the Holy Spirit wants us to feel things, wants us to feel the presence of God, wants us to feel love, wants us to feel all these things. And that's why the Spirit, which comes in the form of a dove, which brings peace, yes, and that's one of the reasons for peace, the dove, which at the Noah event brings back the peace, because it's announcing universal peace. But in order for universal peace to come, it must first burn everything which is impure. And the Holy Spirit actually burns anything which is impure. Burns it away, burns it to a crisp. This is a very common theme found in the Old Testament, the idea of purification by fire. Purification by fire. You'll also find this theme in the New Testament, purification by fire, that it must be beat out as silver and gold is refined in the fire and tempered, not destroyed, but tempered, until it is lean and strong, until it is pure and spotless and holy. That notion of wholeness, which is also associated with holiness. So within this is also why Jesus says, how I wish the world were already set, what, ablaze. Not that he wants to call down fire from heaven to consume and destroy everything, which is actually what James and John wants him to do. James and John said, Lord, call down fire from the heavens to consume the Samaritans who have rejected you. And Jesus says, no. Because that's not the type of consumption that he's talking about. He's talking about destruction. He's talking about purification. It's also why he constantly is telling everyone, repent, repent, repent. Choose to be purified. Choose to be honest. Choose to be humble so that the Holy Spirit can come into one's life. So when you look at the notion of one, we understand that we are all called to be members of one human family. And within this, the one church. We believe that there is only one body of Christ, that there is only one church, because there's only one human family. And therefore, as this, Christ only comes to what? To create one human family. Christ, God does not like division. God does not like disunity. God likes unity. God is unity. Unity despite diversity. And so the church, when we saw the church, the Catholic Church and the one church and things like this, we're not talking about a building. Church is not something which we go to. You could burn down every single church in the world. The church is the people inside of it. St. Peter's Basilica, one of the most beautiful churches, burned to the ground. The church will still survive as long as there's one person, one Catholic who believes, one priest who's still willing to offer the sacrifice of the Mass. This is the church. People, the people of God are the church. If you've ever been to a huge, I just came back from World Youth Day this summer, where you had between 1 and 2 million young people. As you look out over 2 million, as many as 2 million people, all there praising our Lord and praising God, and really truly being kind. It was hard. It was actually one of the hardest, it was a pilgrimage, because it was muddy, it was hard. I walked 18 miles one day. But for the most part, everyone was it was beautiful. There's no fighting. It was beautiful. There was a unity. And actually, this is what God desires for the entirety of the human race, which he doesn't call us to be separated by divisions. He calls us to be united in unity, one with another. But in order for that to happen, we have to also agree that there is only one truth. Because truth is that which unites everything together. Truth is the unity, because truth, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. The one thing which unites us together is our common belief in Jesus and the message which he came to bring. And so Jesus is the truth which unites all people together. You also find this notion that the holiness, that the Holy Spirit who is one and brings the oneness, is that the holiness, which says that the Holy Spirit will always make us holy. But the notion of holy, even when I was a little kid, as well as even in the high school, I heard this word holy, 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 holy. I mean, we say it all the time at Mass. Holy, holy, holy. What the devil does this word even mean? What does holy mean? Okay, I've heard it thousands and millions and thousands of times. Practically speaking, what does holy, practically speaking, mean? Does it mean that I'm what? That I'm white? White, okay, that's what I oftentimes when I was a kid, I thought about it. Purity, okay, but what does it mean? Does it mean sexual purity? Does it mean intellectual? What is pure? Innocence? Well, yeah, but I've lost innocence. So what does holy mean? Yes, it does mean innocence. It does mean purity. But when you also look at the notion of what the word means, it also means holistic. God wants to bring about a holistic, a unity back to ourselves, a unity which is lost and fragmented. One of the effects of the fall is a fragmentation within the individual human person. We are no longer connected to God. God wants us to bring us back into right relationship with ourselves. We don't just go after the needs of the flesh. And we become what? Beasts, or less than beasts in many cases, where you just go after the needs of the flesh. He also doesn't want us just to go after the things of the spirit, just after things, because then you become cold and distant and intellectually smart, but very, very cold, like the Pharisees actually ended up being. One of the first, actually, heresies in the church that was being faced was a heresy called Gnosticism, where people said that the only thing which is good is the spirit. The body is bad. But see, we believe that both are good, that you will find your satisfaction only when you find a balance between the things of the flesh and the things of the spirit. Jesus says you need to be in the world, but not of the world. So this notion between actually the holistic approach to the human person, that we find a balance between the things of the spiritual life, the emotional life, the physical life, the intellectual life. It's interesting also, you will find yourself, if you really actually gauge into it, this is also what we call the virtue of temperance. Temperance is balancing things in your life. And you'll find that if you do, I actually compare work and balancing your areas of a life is to booze, to liquor. It's an easy way to remember it. 8 to 12 hours of physical labor, you will be just as exhausted after 4 hours of emotional or intellectual labor, like wine to beer. And then the first one, that if you have spirits, if you try to drink booze directly, again, what, about one hour? 1 hour of prayer will make you just as tired as about 4 hours of an emotionally dense conversation as if you had just worked, what, 8 to 12 hours. So we're not talking about an equality. Some people think that in order to balance their life, they have to give God everything. They have to give God all of their time. They have to pray for like 14 hours a day, and that's the only time that they actually have fulfilled God's commandments is if they've prayed all day long. Well, actually, no. You're called to balance things in your life. You don't need to pray 14 hours a day, but you do need to pray each and every day. You need to have a chunk of time that you pray, because if you don't have that, you will starve. But likewise, if you only have work, this is the way in which the Holy Spirit comes to give us a spirit, which gives us wisdom, understanding, right judgment, knowledge. So we know where we're being called to be disciplined, but not just following and becoming slaves to obligation. Does this make sense? It's also why we're also called to what? To balance our physical life. We're actually in the seminary. What we were called as priests, we had what we referred to as the four pillars of formation. I know that Jerry had them, I believe, as well, in diaconate formation. Is that we had to, in order to be ordained a priest, we were evaluated and judged on our intellectual awareness, or our intellectual, our academics things. We on our spiritual. We were evaluated and judged on our spiritual qualities and on our prayer. Guys who didn't have a prayer life were kicked out. Guys who didn't study and things like that were kicked out. And if you couldn't balance them, you got kicked out. You had to balance your spiritual life. You had to balance your intellectual life. You also had to be a good pastor, because everyone had a pastoral assignment where you had to go out and do pastoral work with people. And if you were a mean person, then you got kicked out, because you had to balance that as well. And then you also had to balance what I refer to. This was actually the hardest one for me. What was called the human formation. You had to be you had to be a good human being in terms of being organized and being on time and being. These are things which I still struggle with to this day. But all these, so you have the four pillars of formation: intellectual, spiritual, pastoral, and human. That's where we're actually in the human. We even had house jobs. We had to do basic cleaning, like clean toilets and things. I was the bookstore manager. I had to keep books. It was horrible. So when we're looking at the holistic, this is what actually the Holy Spirit comes to make us holy. To be holy, to be, what does it mean to be, what does it mean to be spotless? What does it mean to be these things? It means to be balanced. It means to find that very precarious balance, to find ourselves in humility. Humility will always balance you. That's what we've been talking a little bit about tonight. Again, the body, the spirit, the mind, the holistic approach to the individual, we find ourselves healthy. Even on a body level, we believe that what? We are called to take care of our bodies. We believe that there's a sin associated with when we take our bodies for granted. It's called gluttony. Okay? That we're called to what? We're called to be good stewards of everything that God has given us. And sometimes we struggle. Sometimes we fail. But we're still called to strive for it. When we stop striving for it, we slip into mediocrity. So this wholeness, we're also called to be whole in our relationships. We're called to be balanced in our relationships. We're called not to just work 24/7, third commandment. Take time for rest. Take time for your relationships. Take time to balance yourself in your life. That it actually, in a real human person, is a diamond. And a diamond has multi facets. And so you have to polish every facet of the diamond. Because if you have one or two of those facets, which are really beautiful, and everything else is covered in crud, is that you can't tell the difference between a diamond and a piece of coal. And so we're called to be balanced in all those areas of our life. And actually, the only time we actually find freedom and joy is when we are balanced. When we're out of balance, even if we spend all day long, sometimes as I did in college and high school, playing video games all day long. Mm-hmm. And that's what some people, again, just do one thing all day long. Drink all day long. Again, work all day long. When you just do one thing, your life gets boring. And you're not fulfilled. We're called to be balanced in life, and this is actually what holiness actually entails. Within our families, within our community, people have to be involved in community. Some people who become isolated from community, and some people think that, okay, I can have a relationship with God without a relationship with community. You can't. You can't. If you think you have a relationship with God and you hate people, Jesus says you're a liar. That's what he says. He says, if you say you love God and you don't love your neighbor, you're a liar. That's what it says in the scriptures. You must be in a relationship. And Pope Francis actually just recently took heat for this, because he said people who do not have a relationship with the church do not have a relationship with God. And people are like, he can't say that. Yes, he can, because one, he's a successor of Peter, and two, it says in the scriptures, okay, is that you must be in relationship with others, because if you are truly the child of God, you will naturally speaking have to be a good brother and sister to everyone else. Love God with your whole heart, your whole mind, your whole soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. So within this, we also find that this is what makes us whole, and there's also this notion of purity. Now, the purity, When you talk about purity, which also can mean without error, that's what purity means, without flaw, without stain, like a white garment which has no impurities on it, is that we recognize this. When we talk about the church as being holy in terms of purity, is that what we are not referring to is her individual members. Because you will find her individual members covered with sin very frequently, covered with mud, covered with crime. Again, so when we talk about the holiness, the purity of the church, where there's no spot, there's no blemish, there's no error, it's not within the individual members. And even in terms of the collection of people on earth, you'll still find the church as a whole sometimes makes mistakes. Well, we do say, though, that there is no mistakes, there is no blemish, there is no error, and therefore the church truly is holy. The way that the Holy Spirit will always make us is in terms of her teachings, in terms of the actual dogmas and doctrines. This is where you will find something in reality which is without stain, without blemish, without error. Actually, all of the different things that most people scream and yell about in terms of the church, in terms of the Inquisition, or in terms of the Middle Ages, in terms of persecutions, in terms of Pope selling and buying indulgences, or whatever it was, all these different accusations which are leveled against the Catholic Church, all of these things actually were almost always in violation of church teaching. There were things that individual members did, things that became customary and just became, okay, well, everyone's doing it. But there was always violations. Again, the buying and selling of indulgences was never permitted by church's teaching. Indulgences actually are, by definition, free. There's effort and things that have to go back. But when they started selling, Martin Luther was correct in that and condemning the church. But this was never the church's teachings. In terms of the things that actually were at times permitted, you won't find, actually, that's where you look at the actual teachings of what the church is. And I would say this, I've looked hard and I've not found one, in my opinion, that's which you can find an error with. You can find that it's what? False. You'll find teachings which are incomplete. You will find that, and that's actually what the church does not mean when it says it's without error. Does not mean that it's complete. It just means that there is no direct contradiction to God's law or to things of this nature. Does this make sense? Because when we do say that the church is the one holy Catholic, the one holy, and so in that sense, but we're talking about the dogmas and doctrines, the things which lead us, and actually, the more you embrace the dogmas and doctrines, the more you embrace the actual teachings of the church. That's why Jesus also turns to the Pharisees and to the people. He says, do what they say, but don't do what they do. He says, don't follow their example, because their example is garbage. He says, but that what they're saying is true, just don't follow their example. The same thing is actually true in the church today. Sometimes the leaders in the church, priests, bishops, even the popes, have not provided good examples, but the actual teachings, the more that a person actually embraces the reality of the teachings, which is only possible if you know them, is that actually this will make you, individually speaking, holy. And you will find yourself more and more without stain of sin. So, because that's what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit makes things holy. So, without blemish or error, you'll find the individual members at the end of the day, is what we believe is heaven, when the individual members are without stain. But where we can place our trust and hope for the here and now is within the dogmas, doctrines, and actual official teachings when you look at it. So, we also believe the Catholic Church is universal. And universal because that's what Catholic means, is universal, is that all people are universally called. Anyone can be a member, even the greatest sinners can be members. That everyone, regardless of race, regardless of creed, regardless of where you're born into, regardless of gender, regardless of all these different things, all people are called to salvation. That God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him might not perish, but might have eternal life. And we do say might, and that's a difference actually in the King James Bible. The King James Bible, which has a few errors in translation, if you go back to the ancient ones, it's whoever might not perish, because if it will not, then that takes away your free will. You no longer have free will. But see, it's up to you. Do you want salvation or do you not? Therefore, you always have a choice. You can say no. At any given time, God does not force people into salvation, but he offers it to anyone who wants it. The God so loved the world, he sent his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him might not perish, but might have eternal life. This notion in John 3:16 is that all people are called. You'll find it in Ephesians 1:7. We in him, through the blood, the forgiveness of trespasses, all things are called. You'll find 2 Thessalonians 2:13, The same notion of universal salvation offered to anybody who wants it, anyone who wants to be saved, will be saved. And so when you finally come to that fourth mark of the Holy Spirit, which the Holy Spirit's own identity is authoritative and brings authority and brings dominion and things of this nature, you'll find that this church also is infused with the same authority. And this is probably the biggest hang up that many people have in the Catholic Church, which is the notion of authority. Because with authority also comes grave danger, is that authority can be misused. And authority has been misused. There's no doubt about it. History shows time and time again, people have misused authority, people who should have used it. And actually, if you look at the scriptures, you'll also find in the scriptures that the apostles at times didn't use their authority too greatly. That's why St. Paul actually condemns Peter at one point for what? For being a hypocrite, for using his authority poorly. So even from the very beginning, and the church, God has never, and Jesus didn't himself say that even the leaders in the church will not, what, be without stain of sin. They themselves need a redeemer. And that's actually a lot of times people walk away from church because they say, well, it's filled with hypocrites. This is proof of our need for a church, not an argument against it. Because this is why God came. It's the more that we accept the teachings of Jesus Christ, the more that we live them in our lives, the more we practice them, the more we will find ourselves. But this also means that we need authority. And there's a reason for it, because authority can at times abuse, but authority can also protect. And authority actually has to be there in order to get anything done. And God sends his apostles out with a mission. He actually also sends them out and tells them to protect the word, to protect the church. Peter is entrusted as what? The shepherd to the sheep, to protect. Peter, feed my sheep. Do you love me? Feed my sheep. Feed my sheep, feed my sheep. And if you want to know what that actually means, there's long passages in the Old and New Testament upon good shepherds and bad shepherds, and the distinction, how you can tell the distinction between the two, is that a good shepherd, what, nurtures and takes care of his sheep, doesn't plunder and take from them. So this notion, though, but there is need for shepherds because you need to have something which holds everything together when people have disagreements, because apostolic authority is the glue which unites things together. If you don't have glue, if you don't have the something which sticks things together, is things tend to fragment. Actually, that's what you see. When you don't have anything which is authoritative, things fragment off. Now, some people say that the scriptures are the only authority that one should rely upon, that the scriptures are the only one. Well, that doesn't take into account that the scriptures were compiled by the successors of the apostles, that the apostles were the ones who wrote the scriptures. That doesn't take into account many different problems. It also doesn't take into account that people who say that the scriptures and scriptures alone is the sole authority, that is found nowhere in scripture. That is found, actually, when you find the notion of scriptures talked about in the Bible, you will find always that the notion of scriptures is always associated with someone who has the authority to interpret them. This is actually what the scriptures themselves say, is that the scriptures, what? Different people have the ability to interpret. This is what St. Paul talks about to St. Timothy. Interpretation of scriptures, that some people have the interpretation, some people have teaching, some people have this, not everyone is the same. There's different members in the body. And so because without it, you'll find fragmentation, because these 12, and actually the successors of these 12, which there's thousands today, again, anyone who is, people who say that the term bishop is not found, the term bishop is found in the scriptures, because the scripture, which refers to bishop, which is one with authority, is episkopos. And you'll find that in the Acts of the Apostles. You'll find that in the New Testament with St. Paul. It'll actually, St. Paul will tell Timothy, he'll say, be very careful in who you lay your hands on. Because once you've laid your hands on and given authority to him, you can't take it back. Those of you who, we've walked through some of this in my history course, for those of you who took the history course. So within this notion of apostolic authority is that the apostles, because then you have a question of how do you know what is the actual teachings of Christ? Because a lot of people disagree on what the actual teachings are. And a lot of people have disagreed on how the Bible is to be interpreted. A lot of people say that these weren't actually Jesus' words. This is this. This is this. So then the question becomes, how do you know with competing claims which one is true and which one's not? Because if you say that there's no way of knowing, then what you actually have to say as a consequence of that is that Christ abandoned his church. Because if there's no way of knowing Jesus' authentic words, then Christ abandoned us, which is actually not the mark of a loving God or a loving bridegroom. But Christ doesn't abandon us. Christ leaves us with people who can speak and act on his behalf. And this is also found in the Old Testament as well. You'll find that in the Old Testament, there was always what? Judges. Judges who could make determinations. Again, two people who had competing claims. And one of these judges that you'll find very clearly, who is infused with wisdom, which is actually the Holy Spirit, infuses wisdom. One of these judges is the wisest man in all of Scripture, which is King Solomon. King Solomon, who has two women who come with competing claims that both of this is my son. And if you know the story, Solomon says, we'll tear the child in half and give one half to each side. And then one of the women says, all right. And the other one starts screaming and flipping out and saying, no, give the child to him. And then Solomon says, that's the real mother. Give the child to that one. Because what? He has wisdom. Does this mean that Solomon is without error? Solomon actually leads the people of Israel astray because he's like his father. He has no control over lust. And he takes many women who shouldn't be his wives, and actually many foreign women will leave Solomon's hearts astray. But yet, in terms of wisdom, in terms of his ability to judge Israel and to judge it with wisdom, actually Solomon is very effective in that, which is why he's remembered as one of the greatest kings. So you'll find that this notion of authority, that God will use imperfect instruments to protect his people in the Old Testament, as well as that Jesus will leave behind imperfect instruments to protect his people, to protect his sheep. And these are what are called the shepherds, or the episcopos, the bishops. You'll also find this term in the New Testament called presbyter, the priests, the ones who help the bishops. And you'll also find this notion of what's called deacons. Thank you. We got one right here. One who serves. Yep. Actually, every priest and every bishop is also a deacon, just so you know. We'll get to that when we get to holy orders. Now, you will find that this notion of authority is, you will find that with authority, when people make determinations and when the authority speaks, it does bind people and actually binds them also to obedience. And this is what many people find very confining. They don't like it, is being bound and being told what they can do or they can't do, or what they must believe or what they must not believe. And so some people find this to be confining. It is confining, but it also creates boundaries, boundaries for reality. Boundaries which protect us, boundaries which define us. And actually the first, if you look back at people who did not like boundaries from the very beginning, it was not Adam and Eve, it was Satan himself who defied God. Who defied what? He rebelled against the authority of God. You'll find that the very first time that there is sin in existence comes through one who rebels against the authority of God. And as Milton says, is that better to reign in hell than to serve in heaven. Better to be my own authority in hell, I can define and do everything I want, as opposed to serve and actually be subject to another in heaven. And so within this, you'll find that the rebellion against authority is something which is very ancient, both in the Old Testament, and you'll still find this in the New. Satan deceives also Adam and Eve into rebelling against God's authority, although they've already been granted a certain limited, but there still is limitations on their power. There's limitations of what they can do and what they can't do, although they have freedom. When they violate that, they find themselves in slavery. And there's also in the New Testament, there are limitations, boundaries, things that define us, things that, and we have ones who can speak on those different matters, as also human history continues to evolve. And actually, you'll find that the church will also continue to evolve with it, bringing God's truth into our evolving world. Because the things that were faced the early church are very different than the things that we face today in terms of technology, in terms of culture, in terms of knowledge, in terms of science, in terms of these. And that's also why Jesus tells his disciples what? Is that your faith is the size of a mustard seed, but it must grow into the largest of all trees. That the notion of the faith is something which is meant to expand and grow. And that what? The Holy Spirit will guide you into all truth. In John, I believe, chapter 15. The Holy Spirit, John's 14 through 17, talks all about the Holy Spirit guiding and leading the church into the fullness of truth. When Jesus himself is gone, he will leave the Holy Spirit among his church to lead and to guide it through its shepherds. What time have I got? All right, go more quickly, finish up. So again, no authority, no effect. And Jesus leaves the same command as was left to Adam and Eve, to be fruitful and multiply. They're called to be gardeners, and they're called to use their authority as gardeners, which is a gardener is one who serves. That's actually even the notion of service and the authority, which is meant to be used in the church, is that all authority in the church is also always meant to be used to serve, which is why anything which, again, says to use authority for one's own promotion or to use it for one's own self-worth and things like this is all actually abuses of authority. So I'm going to go a little bit more quickly since I'm running out of time and I want you guys to be able to go home tonight. It's also why when Jesus uses his authority and bestows his authority upon the apostles, he will leave his authority and he will give it to the church. But he will also, before he gives the authority of the Eucharist, before he gives the authority of salvation, before he gives it to them, he shows them exactly how they're called to use this authority. As he gets down and washes the apostles' feet. Because he's about to give them one of the greatest authorities, one of the greatest powers that the world has ever seen, which is the ability to bring him into the room through the Eucharist. Right before he does the Eucharist, though, he gets down and washes their feet to show them, do not become puffed up. Know what this is authority for. A true king, which is that Jesus is our king, a king is not one who is served by his people, but a king is one who gets down and serves his people. So, in correlation with this, Jesus also predicts that the apostles will all abandon him. Right after this, they all say we can do it, and they can't because they don't yet have the Spirit. And you'll find that Jesus, in this, again, truly, truly, I say, whoever believes in me will do works, will do the works that I do, and greater ones than these because I go to my Father. Jesus predicts that the church will do things which is even greater than he will do, which is pretty marvelous. No individual member, though, in the church has ever exceeded Jesus in terms of what he's done. But as collectively, as a collective whole, as the entire church most certainly has actually done things even greater than Jesus in his lifetime did, because the Holy Spirit is with us, leading us. The Father will give you another consoler. Consoler is another word for spirit, to be with you forever. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because another sees him nor knows him, and you know him, for he dwells with you and will be with you. The consoler, the Holy Spirit, again, you did not choose me, I chose you, appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide. In order to bear fruit, again, you have to have the ability to do so. When the Spirit comes, I will send to you from the Father the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father. He will bear witness to me, and you also, because you have been with me from the beginning. Nevertheless, I tell you, it is the truth. It is your advantage I go away. For if I do not go away, the Consoler will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convince the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment, of sin because they do not believe in me. Which is what? That the Spirit, when Jesus goes away, is going to continuously point out people's sins. Some people don't like it when the church calls out certain things as sins. They don't like it when they're, what, told that this is wrong. But that the Spirit, some people are like, we don't need to focus on sin anymore. Though, if the Holy Spirit truly comes, the Spirit is still going to start continuously pointing out where people are wrong, and it will, what, not humiliate them, but it will humble them. Yeah, question.
This is John.
This is John, yeah. John chapter 16:7, yeah. I have many things yet to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. What, the notion of the growing faith. Because some people say, well, we need to go back to the way it was in the early church. This is a very simple faith in the early church. Nope, Jesus predicted that the faith would need to grow. To what? To account for the needs of the time. He will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. So what is everything that is Jesus's? He's giving to his bride, giving to us. The greatest thing he gives to us is his Spirit. The Father has his mind, therefore I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. So when you look at actually the church, you will find the 12 apostles upon which Jesus builds his church will do exactly what Jesus said. They will send out other people. You will find that Barnabas and Paul will be commissioned by James, John, and by Peter. They will go out. And actually, just because you're one of the 12, some of the 12 we know nothing about. Some of the 12, they were, as far as we can tell, actually, at least in the long term, weren't successful in creating long-standing churches. Sometimes it'll be the disciple, it'll be the people coming out of the 12. Paul will be the most effective preacher of the gospel. And Paul was not one of the 12. Just because a person was one of the member of the 12 didn't mean that you were going to be a great. Again, why? Because it's the Spirit chooses, the Spirit wills. But still, you will still find this notion. Paul will send out Luke. Luke will go out, and actually a different community can still trace themselves. Mark will be sent out by Peter. Mark will go to Alexandria in Egypt. And if you read the early church fathers, this is the history of where they go. Antioch becomes a main bed of Christianity in the early church. Antioch, which is in Turkey. First of all, Peter will end up there. And then later, after Peter, he will have to leave. And he will leave a man by the name of Evodius. Evodius will die shortly. He'll be killed shortly. And Evodius will leave behind a man by the name of Ignatius. Ignatius, we still have Ignatius' letters to us today. And this is what was referred to as the patristics, the early church fathers. And you can still read St. Ignatius' letters. You'll find that eventually Peter will end up in Rome along with Paul. They will found the church in Rome when Peter is killed by Nero. He will leave behind a man by the name of Linus. And that Linus will shortly be killed. He'll leave behind a man by the name of Clement, who's in charge of the community there. We still have Clement's letters to this day. You'll find, again, Paul will also help with the church in Rome. Paul will establish many communities, especially in Greece, Galatia, Corinth, Philippi, Thessalonica, later on in Rome. You'll find that Paul will send out Timothy. Timothy will end up in Ephesus. You can still go and see Ephesus to this day. I just got back from there. Polycarp is actually a listener. He's a disciple of John, and this is in Smyrna, another place all in that same area of Mesopotamia. Smyrna, which is actually where St. Nicholas will eventually come from. If you know St. Nicholas, was the bishop of, I believe, of Smyrna, if I remember correctly. I could be wrong on that. But a person who listens to Polycarp will be a man by the name of Irenaeus. Irenaeus is probably one of the greatest thinkers in the early church, and he will contribute more to theology in the early church than almost any other thinker. And we have all of Irenaeus' writings. But again, you'll find John will also be helped, and they all are working together. You won't find that there's competition at this time. There's a little bit of, again, obviously politics going back and forth. That's why Paul has to address it at various times. He says, you're not disciples of Apollos, you're not disciples of Peter, you're not disciples of Paul, you're all disciples of Jesus Christ. He said, stop this stupid fracturing. That's what Paul will actually talk about a lot. Why? Because people are doing it. Sometimes people think that there was, in the early church, everything was wonderful and peaceful and things like that. No, there was church politics even at that time. There was politics, there was community politics, there was church politics, there was all these things. That's why the leaders are speaking out against it, saying that no, this is not the way that Christ wants it for us. He wants us to be in unity with one another. You won't find even, again, it's not just Paul, James, you'll also find that St. Thomas will end up in India. St. Thomas Christians and other different Christians in India can trace themselves to the authority of Thomas, Father Raj, although he doesn't trace himself to Thomas, but you know a lot of people of that. From India, you'll find the Armenians, Orthodox, don't trace themselves to Andrew, which is oftentimes what many people think. Actually, the Armenian Orthodox can trace themselves to Bartholomew and to Jude, who established the church there. And then finally, the second biggest church in the world, which is an apostolic church, will be what's referred to as the Greek Orthodox. The Greek Orthodox, which was established by the brother of Peter, Andrew. And we were actually in, we don't have enough time. I do have all of this, but I don't have enough time to go through this tonight. where the apostles ended up in terms of that. Skip ahead. Ran out of time. So when you look at, this is from a couple of years ago, so this is not up to date, but world religion demographics. So 50%, 33%, this was as of a few years ago, because I believe the Muslims now have equaled out to Christians. I believe the Muslims now are slightly above more populous than Christians. But if you look at the world religion demographics, Roman Catholicism comprises of half of Christians across the planet. We are the largest single body of Christians united under the authority of the Pope, under the authority of the successor of Peter. But we recognize, actually, anyone who traces themselves back to an apostle, we recognize that as an authentic church. People who can't trace themselves back to an apostle, we recognize that there's a validity to them and that there's a goodness within that, but we don't call them a church per se. We call them a community. And so therefore, because there are certain sacraments which require authority, there are certain sacraments which don't require authority. The sacraments which require authority must be able to trace themselves back to an apostle. The sacraments which don't. So therefore, we will recognize actually the baptisms of any denomination. We will recognize as long as a person was baptized by water and was baptized in the name of the Trinity, we will accept that baptism because we don't believe that baptism takes authority. But there are certain sacraments which not just anyone can do. You have to be commissioned and you have to be chosen and you have to be able to trace yourself to an authentic apostle who has the truth and who the truth was traced to, because you have lots of competition. That's the whole point of what all the heresies, if you heard the word heresy, heresy is a person who has deviated from the authentic gospel. But then the question is, well, why is that person's opinion not this? Because they disagreed with the successors who were given the authentic gospel by Jesus. So therefore, when you look at this, you'll find that we will accept, for instance, Eucharist. The Eucharist is not something that just anyone can do. It is something which requires authority, because if you think that just any Joe Blow off the street can just turn bread and wine into the body and blood of Christ, well, you can think that, but it doesn't happen. You have to be commissioned. Jesus himself commissioned the apostles. Likewise, confirmation. Not anyone can give what? A commissioning, an authority which is given to that. Confirmation takes authority. Priestly office takes authority. Not just anyone can just, some people just like, okay, well, I'm going to become the priest, or I've nominated myself as bishop, and then they call themselves bishops. Okay, that's, well, bishop of what? Because bishops, have to trace themselves to an apostle. People who just claim the title, anyone can claim, obviously, the title. But then the question becomes, is it a legitimate title? Because we believe that titles mean something. And so therefore, priestly office, Eucharist, confirmation, all require authority. But the other sacraments are also anointing of the sick and confession, the binding and loosing. We'll get to that. But certain sacraments, such as marriage, don't require authority. That's why we recognize marriages from other denominations. Also, certain baptism doesn't require authority. We recognize that in other denominations as well. Does this make sense? And the reason for this is that, again, we obviously, since the Middle Ages, we've had a lot of fracturing in Christianity as a whole. But in terms of actually our gospel, our message, as well as the morals, the teachings of our faith, have evolved and have grown over time, but we have never changed any tenet of our faith. We have always remained consistent, and we can trace ourselves as the Catholic Church all the way back to the very beginning. The only one who massively can do this at the same time will be the Greek Orthodox, but the Orthodox, you'll see again, is much smaller denomination, about 11% versus the 50 of the world's denomination. Here's another smaller one. You can see, again, Baptist comprise against. Sometimes some people think that it's bigger than it is, but actually if you look at the world's population, there are more Catholics, Roman Catholics, than anything else, which is also why when people levy accusations as well as hostility, it's usually the Catholics who are the first ones to get hit, because we're the largest single denomination. Most other denominations can't be hit because they don't have a single leader, as well as they don't have enough members. It's also why, if you read recently in politics, the various politicians and their staffs aren't very happy with the Catholic Church, and I'm very happy about that. Because that's, you know what? The church will always stand in conflict with various ideologies which lead people astray. Plain and simple. And the church has been doing that for a long time. There's been lots of people who have said that the church needs to change and the church is going to die, and those persons are all dead. Those persons have also, all of their kingdoms have fallen apart. And it's not recently, this is not the first one. Hitler said the same thing. Before that, Napoleon Bonaparte said the same thing before he got exiled to Elba, before Hitler died by his own hand. You'll also find that Frederick Barbarossa said the same thing. You'll find lots of people have said that the church has to change. The church has to get up with the times. The church has to do this. And we haven't done that. We remain consistent. We remain consistent to the teachings that have come to us through the apostles from the person of Jesus Christ, and we see which one has lasted. Because that's actually how you usually can tell where truth is, because truth cannot be destroyed. Lies eventually corrode and destroy over time. So when you look, many persons, again, claim the authentic gospel of Jesus Christ, but when they all contradict each other, not all of them can be correct. Now, some of them might all be wrong, but you can't have two things which are diametrically opposed be correct. Muslims will actually claim, though, that Christianity lost the authentic gospel. They said that the Muslims will claim that Judaism perverted the intentional word of God. They don't believe that the Bible has any authority. But then you'll also find people like Joseph Smith from the Mormons who will say that, okay, the apostles had authority, but somehow it died with them and it never transmitted forward until all of a sudden the angel Gabriel came, and then you had the apostles came and gave the authority of the apostles to Joseph Smith, is it? I think. Huh? Baloney, yeah. So Joseph Smith said that all of a sudden the apostles came and gave it to this, denying 1800 years. But again, that's where they'll still, that's why in the Mormon faith they'll say that they have apostolic authority. Although they can't trace it for 1800 years, it came all of a sudden by a mystical experience by their leader with special glasses to read the stones and things like this. So how do you determine which one is real and which one is false? We would say that you use reason. We would say that you don't have to just use faith, although we have faith and we can rely upon faith. You also look at reason. What is reasonable is that you trace yourself backwards. And you can find that early Christianity, you will find that we have split from some of the other apostolic churches because of differences. But where do you trace the authority backwards? And this is basically a breakdown of where you can trace the authority backwards, going back to where the church actually starts from and where every denomination starts or where it comes about in the human history, in the history of what we call the history of salvation. So, God gave us also reason, because we believe as Catholics that God also reveals to us in faith, but also he reveals us to us in reason. We believe that we can use both, that faith and reason is like my thumb and forefinger, and between them I can grasp everything. That's what a Pulitzer Prize winner said in the 1920s. So he does not ask us to believe the irrational. Is that he gave us reason to encounter him within reason, and therefore we are not called to believe things which are irrational. Is that we are not defeatists as Catholics. We believe that defeatism is that what? By faith and faith alone. That you have to accept this as being true because I said so, because I'm the authority. We're not defeatists. We will explain and we will give a rational, reasonable reason for everything that we believe. You might not like our reason. You might, but you won't find a contradiction within it, if that makes sense. We are very consistent in at least the logic, sometimes too consistent for some. But you will find that we will use reason, and that's why we believe in the complementarity between faith and reason. We believe that we can use both, and there's actually a document from the Second Vatican Council which talks all about the use of faith and reason. Every dogma and doctrine has a rational, reasonable way in which we understand this to happen. We don't believe that there is anything which you must believe which is completely on a thing of faith and faith alone. Does this make sense? That's actually where we have also the growth in theology. It's people trying to understand these principles which we know are true, but therefore you have what? You won't find the term Trinity in the Bible. You'll find the notion Father, Son, Spirit, but you won't find that term Trinity in the Bible. Trinity came about later from the Council of Nicaea because people wanted to understand these realities, understand what Jesus said, understand them in fullness. And so you'll find the growth in faith and the growth in theology using primarily church, and the church could use just faith, and could use just defeatism, could say, well, we're the authority and believe it, but we don't. We always, behind every single dogma, the dogmas of Mary, we always believe that there is some way in which we can rationally understand how this actually happens. Because many people oftentimes say that the church is wrong. The church does not disagree with science. The church does disagree sometimes with the applications of science. And they also disagree with the implications of what people believe science is leading to. We don't disagree with hard science when hard science presents itself. Well, what people try to say that this hard science actually means, that we will disagree with. So did the church disagree with people like Copernicus or people like Galileo or people who are starting to do this? No, but the church did tell some of these people, slow down. Because what they were doing, the church didn't disagree with their science. What they started disagreeing with was what they were trying to say that the science meant. That human beings, in the case of like Darwin, human beings came from apes. And the church was like, you're making an extrapolation without actually even the hard data and the hard science, which we still don't have to this day, that missing link. My background's in anthropology, is that we still don't have the missing link. If they haven't, actually everything has been disproved in terms of the missing link. I'm not saying that we didn't evolve from apes. I personally don't believe it, but still, if there's actually science, we might take a look at that, but until there's actually science, but when Galileo was trying to make theological, and when they were trying to make theologicals, because actually remember, many of these people were Catholic Christians, very strong Christians, but they're trying to make theological assumptions and theological implications of what this actually meant. That's when the church came in and said, no, you're stepping too quickly, you're moving too quickly, and actually most of those theories actually have been, the theological ones have all been debunked, not the actual hard science. So this makes sense. And actually, because the church has always been the patron of the sciences, the university system started at the behest of the Catholic Church. Actually, all that we have in terms of faith, in terms of science, in terms of universities and education, the church is very much interested in education because we believe that it's a way in which we encounter truth. And that we don't believe that the truth ever contradicts with God or with even with scripture and things like that. But there's ways in which we understand that. So, the church is in disagreement at times with the interpretation of proposed meanings and applications of science. The same thing will be true with the scriptures. The church will oftentimes leave the scriptures very open to interpretation. The church doesn't like to define things and use her authority to say that certain passages of scripture mean one thing and one thing alone. The church is very hesitant to say that because the scriptures have multiple layers to them. But at various times, the church will come out against a particular person who says, this is what the scriptures mean. And especially when it contradicts other parts of the scriptures or it contradicts the faith, the church will come out and say, no, that's an inaccurate interpretation of the scripture. And if the person persists in that, or they persist in denying certain parts of scripture or certain parts of dogmas and doctrines, the church will come out and declare it to be what we have a wonderful term called heresy. Heresy, which means a lie. It's a theological lie. It's a theological inaccuracy. It's not the authentic truth. Does this make sense? Because the church, for the most part, will leave all of scripture up to your individual reading and you interpret it yourself, but just don't. And what the church does say in terms of the interpretations of scripture is submit your interpretation to the wisdom of the church. And if your interpretation contradicts, but for the most part, there's very few things that the church is actually going to come out and say. But when you come out, and when Luther came out and said, the church actually didn't even have a problem with his criticism of the selling of indulgences and things like that. We've owned up to that. But in terms of what? Sola scriptura? The scriptures and scriptures alone are the sole authority when it's not found in scripture, and it contradicts other parts of the scriptures, the church came out and said, this is wrong. This is heresy. This is not one containing the scriptures. It goes against the deposit of the faith, the tradition, as well as it goes against reason as well. Does this make sense? So when looking, again, in the church, you'll also find people in the church finding this very interesting role playing between two, at times, opposing sides. This is from the last election. Yeah, I should. I don't know if we can find one, but I don't know if we can get the other two into the same room together. But you will find that actually the church will have conversations with the right, and the church will have conversations with the left, because we believe that we are called to unify the two, and that Jesus can actually unify the extremes if we allow him. It will be a miracle, proof of God. And likewise, we always have free will, but still, we are called to unify. And that's why a lot of people get upset, because they say, well, this person was talking to that person over there. This church person shouldn't be talking to that person. No, we have to be in dialogue. We have to be, even with people we disagree with, we have to be in dialogue with them, because that's what Jesus did. Jesus talked to people he disagreed with all the time. And Jesus never said, oh, your opinion is good and valid. No, Jesus said, your opinion is wrong, but here's the truth. And the church does the same thing with both the right and with the left. Pope Francis has been doing it quite frequently because Pope Francis is great for upsetting everyone. He's upset the far right and he's upset the far left. And that's actually what the church is good for doing. It's pulling the extremes to the center and finding a balance. So within that, you'll also find that the church will at times very publicly come out against positions. The church never criticizes, or actually the church will very rarely come out against an individual unless that individual has made some type of huge, colossal scandal. Very rarely will the church actually do that. But against positions, against things which we view as wrong, against organizations, against things like that, we will come out against that very strongly. You won't hear the church ever, for the most part in the United States, ever affirm that you need to vote for one candidate or the other. But we will come out against platform decisions. We will come out against organizations like Planned Parenthood, and we'll say that these things are not only corrupt, but they are immoral, and they're doing practices which are immoral. Everything within it, no. But some of the main things within it, yes, absolutely. You'll also find that the church will come out and say that certain things in terms of the environment is that we have certain responsibilities to that, and we can't just strip mine and do things like this. We have to look towards future generations, that we hold the planet in common. So the church will take some very uncomfortable and likewise difficult positions in the world today, but that's because we believe that we are called to what? To be good stewards of the authority which God has entrusted to us, both as a church, as a planet, and as a human race. So again, that defeatism, again, doesn't really help when trying to convince people. But likewise, without any authority whatsoever, when you totally abandon authority, you end up in anarchy. And actually, this an anarchy that you only have fracturing chaos and divisions. And you'll find that faith and reason, as well as within the authority of the church, is one of the primary ways in which we validate many of the things which we believe. So any questions? All right. I had to cut some out, but I know that everyone's tired, and I'm tired. I've been going for like 3 days. So let's go ahead and end for tonight, and I'll stay around for any questions anyone has. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time to come together tonight. We just ask you, Lord, to send down your Spirit upon us. Help us to see more clearly where you are leading and guiding us into the fullness of truth, into your deeper encounter with your love. Just ask you, Lord, to keep us safe on the road home tonight. Help us to be lights within our family, of sources of joy, and help us to promote the gospel in what we say and how we live. We ask all this through the intercession of the words which Christ gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen.